Hello and welcome to the BBC Learning English Live Friday Quiz. My name is Dylan and I'm your host again today. So good to see you all, many familiar names coming in already. Hi everybody, how are you today? Happy Friday. Now today we're looking at a topic which is very close to my heart, reading books and fiction. So let's warm up by telling me your name. Tell me where you're from and what is your favourite book. So let's see who we've got today. Is it Chuan? Hi, we've got Heidi from Lima, Peru. Hello, happy Friday to you all. Huda Huda, good to see you again. Azusa, hi from Japan. And Watashi, also from Japan. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, wherever you are in the world. We've got Bice Ice again from Korea. Hi. We've got Nuri from Indonesia and hi from Belgium. Let's have a look. Martin says, good morning. Have a great Friday from Nebraska. Hi to you. All right then. And loads of people coming in. We got Katarina from Indonesia. And you like horror novels? Me too. I'm a big, big Stephen King fan. Horror novels are some of my favorite type of books. So, few ground rules, few guidelines. There are 8 questions in total. We do the questions first and we look at the answers later on. Next, it is just for fun. There are no prizes. It is just for fun. It's just to learn something and have a good time on this Friday. And last of all, please like, comment and share. If you're having a good time, hit that like button, comment. The more you engage, the more you will learn, the more likely you are to remember these terms. And of course, share with your friends, family members, teachers, students, anybody you think would enjoy this, share it, the more the merrier. Okay, back to the comments. We got Aline says, I love terror books. So I think when you say terror, I think you mean horror books. So in English, we call them horror novels or horror stories. Good, we've got people from Laos saying hello and Indonesia, Mozambique. We've got some Thai people in. Hello from Myanmar, from Philippines, Bangladesh, Cambodia. Hello to you all. So are you ready to begin? So Sophia says, a big fan of books, big fan of reading. Great. And Nora says, I like mystery books. And mystery is spelled M-Y-S-T-E-R-Y, mystery books. So let's get started with round one of the live Friday quiz. Okay. So here, first question is talking about when we quickly read a book to get the main meaning. What is this called? So this is when you don't read every single word. You don't sit down and you look and go, okay, this, and you read every word, every page, but you quickly, I almost gave the word away. You quickly go through it to get the main meaning. Do we call this A, scanning, B, speed reading, C, binging, or D, skimming? What do you think? So this is when we're looking for the main idea, for the main gist, or just picking little parts that we think look interesting. Is it scanning, speed reading, binging, or skimming? And a variety of choices coming in, but lots and lots of D's and lots of A's coming in. Okay, so do you agree? Do you think it's A or D? Or I can see a few people go for speed reading and binging. What do you think when you're quickly reading to get the main idea? Browsing, says Dalil. So browsing we use when we are online. So when we're just looking online of different things, we call that browsing. But good answer, good comment. Okay, lots and lots of D's coming in. We've got D's, B. Few more A's. I'll give you a few more seconds to keep your answers coming in, and then we're going to move on to question number two. So three, two, one. On we go. Round two of the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz. And round two, we're looking at idioms, okay? And we're looking at which of these is not a book-related idiom. So which of these is not a book-related idiom? Is it A, an open book, B, a closed book, or C, off the book? So we're looking, you know, we're talking about books, fiction, reading today. These are all, oh, two of them are book-related idioms, but one of them is not. Which one is not a real idiom? Let's take a look. So we have, somebody's asking, where are you from? I am from Wales in the UK. Where are you from? So we've got off the book. See, we got a closed book. Veronica also agrees, has a closed book. Rahilla's going for A, an open book. A number of people going for C here. Evgeny's gone for a closed book. And Maya agrees. So which of these is not a book-related idiom? And if you know it, if you know which ones are not, which one is not, could you tell me and make a sentence with the ones which are a real idiom? Musa saying off the book. Maid or Made saying for B, a closed book. So ooh, the two questions so far, a little bit of disagreement on what you think the correct answer is. Keep your answers coming in. Three, two, one, and we are moving on to round three. Okay, round three, what have we got? Aha, a little bit of a grammar question here. And I want you to fill the blank space, please. So I, loads of books over lockdown. So I, loads of books over lockdown. So have a look. Think, is this the past? Is it the present? Is this the future? And what's the correct form of the verb to go in here? So I, loads of books over lockdown. And that's very true for me. Over lockdown, we couldn't go out. We couldn't go to the cinema. We couldn't go to the bars or restaurants. So I, loads of books. Okay, so we've got lots of B's coming in. We've got a few C's. Okay, and if you think you know the correct answer, what is the pronunciation? Have a think to yourself, how do you pronounce this word? Okay, Alessandra says, it's B, read, which is the simple past. Do you agree with Alessandra or not? Okay, we've got, like I said, a few C's, but mostly B's coming in. A few more seconds to get your answers in. And Anacha agrees with Alessandra, says, I read, it's the past tense. Do you agree with those two? Keep your answers coming in. Round four. Round four, a little bit different today because it's about reading. I thought I'd add a little bit of reading for you. So I'm going to match the word with the correct definition. So on the left, we've got the word. On the right, we've got the definition. Can you match them together? So the three words are plot, chapter, and blurb. And the three definitions are the description of the book on the back cover, the main events of the book, and C, a section of the book. So here are three words which are very useful when talking about buying or reading a book, but which word matches with which definition? So let's look at Hung. Hung Fu says one is B, two is C, and three is A. Do you agree with Hung or do you think something different? So Merch, 2C, 1A, 3B. So slightly different from Hung. Two, chapter, yeah, which definition do you think? Let's have a look. We've got 1B, 2C, 3A. Oof, okay, so take your time, have a read carefully, think about it. Which words? Plot, chapter blurb match these definitions: the description of the book on the back cover, the main events of the book, or C, a section of the book. Okay, and we got a nice bit of variety coming in. Okay, we got, let me see, we had a comment here. Okay, give me your Insta ID, your YouTube channel. You can find us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube at BBC Learning English. Okay, BBC Learning English, we're on all the major social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. You can find us there. Check us out. We've got loads and loads of great content for you. Okay, a few more seconds. I'm going to move on. Get your answers coming in. Quick. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. And we're off to round 5, which, as many of you will know, is the mystery guest. Now, this guest is a very close friend of the show. I don't think you'll be too surprised to see it is...
Right. Hello. What was that? Hello, Dylan, and hello, everybody. Hello.
Yeah. What an entrance, Roy.
It's me again. I know, the booms and bangs somewhere that have just destroyed something. Hello, it's everybody.
Good. It's good to see you. I haven't seen you for a few weeks. How are you?
I'm very well. I'm very well. A little bit wet. I took my dog Leia for a little walk, and I didn't anticipate the rain.
Yeah, I got a little bit of an Elvis look going on, a rockabilly look.
Thanks.
Yeah, I see it again, right? That people are saying, are we twins?
We are, yeah. No, I'm gonna spread this rumor. Hey, Evgeny, I just seen Evgeny's comment. Hey, Pierre. Yeah. Lots of Marta. Hey, Marta. Yeah, I'm gonna spread this. I'm gonna spread this rumor. Let's write a book about it. Yeah. About our lives as separated twins.
All right. And Roy, today we're talking about books and reading. Are you a big reader? Are you a fan of books?
I love reading. I love reading a lot. I don't read as much as I would like to. And I don't think that's a bad thing. I have a lot of students over the past that said they're not big readers. And I think there's lots of different wonderful ways that you can listen and learn stories. Books and reading is phenomenal. I love it. But you can also watch documentaries. There's lots of different ways to get your information. And audiobooks is a great way to also... read, but not read, if you know. So sometimes while I'm on the train, I stick my headphones in and my earphones in. And I've just seen Carla's comment, lol, twins, who is the evil one?
Yeah.
There's no evil twins here. We're just...
I think I know who I'd pick.
Yeah. Well, no, it's that way, isn't it? But I do love books. But of course, there's lots of different ways that you can appreciate books. If, for example, you don't have time to read, which is a sad state of thing to say, but yeah.
Okay. So, Roy, you've been an English teacher for a long time. What are some of your tips for somebody who'd like to improve their reading skills?
Okay. So I've taught over the years a lot of kind of exam English. And one thing that they tell you to do, I'm going to get the word right here, is gist reading. So before you go into a text, and it's not just good for exams, it's good for all manners of kind of books, like news articles and things like this, all manners of readings. You need to have an idea of what you're going to read before you read it. So, for example, if there's a title in a newspaper article and a picture or in an exam, for example, get an idea of what you think you're going to read. That's the first thing I would say. And also, if you're going to speed read, basically the primary reading, I would say, in an exam or even in kind of learning from a book, is to read and get a general idea. I think you used this this technique earlier. I'm trying not to use the word to read as much as you can, because there are some words that are more important to pick on in a reading text than others. For example, let me give you an example sentence. I have been to Paris. I have been to Paris, and this is good for speaking as well. It teaches us where to put the emphasis. In that sentence, there are two grammar words that you don't need to read to understand. I have been to Paris, I been Paris. So that's how we read as well, picking out the important words to get an understanding of what you're going to read.
So focusing on the main words, key ideas, and a bit of preparation before leaving that.
And one other thing I'd say for an exam technique, sometimes you're asked to find specific pieces of text. A question will say, find this. Now, if you read from left to right, as I do, I read left to right, try looking for the words or the information from right to left or down to up. Go against your natural way, because when you read the same way that you normally read, you're going to read more information. You're going to pick out every word. You're going to read rather than search the text. I know this is kind of exam readings, but I think this is important.
Very important for many of our learners, I'm sure. Roy, do you have a reading / book question for us today?
No. Yeah, of course I do. Of course I do. Okay, so someone who reads a lot of books is called A, a bookworm, B, a reading mouse, or C, a novel cat. Okay. So my question today.
One more time.
One more time for fun. My question number 5 is this. Someone who reads a lot of books is called A, a bookworm, B, a reading mouse, C, a novel cat.
Okay, nice question. I can see a few people asking, who is your favorite author, Roy? Who do you like to read?
Do you know, I've got a lot of them. I quite like, Flo. There's a lot of writers that I like to read. I like some of the philosophical texts. People like Albert Camus. Obviously, they're translated into English because I can't read French, I'm afraid. But I think probably my favorite book of all time, it's a classic. It's George Orwell's 1984. I love my kind of dystopian dark future, or in that case, dark past, literature, like apocalyptic or dystopian.
Excellent choice. Roy, thanks for your tips. I can see a lot of people saying they really appreciate it. And somebody's got an exam tomorrow, so they said it's going to be particularly useful for them.
Well, good luck with that one. Very, very best. Let us know afterwards how you're doing your exam, please.
Exactly. Cool. Enjoy your weekend. Happy Friday. See you soon.
Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the quiz, guys. And thanks for the warm welcome. Bye.
Bye, Roy. Okay. So we've got some people that sent in their favourite authors. So Stephen King, Jane Austen and the Bronte sister. Very, very good choices, actually. I like all of those. And yes, Carla saying 1984 is where Big Brother made the first appearance. And then we know that term in real life, of course, or in popular culture. If Jenny's going for bookworm, we've got bookworm. We've got, let's have a look, bookworm, reading mouse. We've got a few people going for novel cat, but they've gone, I think, Akmal. But I'd say about 75% of you going for a bookworm. So we're going to move on back to the quiz. We've got round 6. And here we are looking for a vocabulary word about stories, about novels. What do we call the time and place where a story happens? Do we call it the location? Do we call it B, the setting, or C, the event? So this is the time and the place where a story happens. Do we call it the location, the setting, or the event? Okay, let's see what we've got. So Min is going for B, the setting. Abdelal, so event C. Lynn agrees. We've got a few Bs. B and C seem popular. Location, says Rahila. And summing up what many people seem a bit unsure about is between B and C. Is it the event or is it the setting? So this is the time and place. And let me give you a little example. So let's choose Lord of the Rings. Lord of the Rings is set on Middle Earth or in Middle Earth. And the time is somewhere in the past. Somewhere in the vaguely past times. So That would be the location, the setting, or the event. What do you think? So we've got setting, we've got location, setting, and event. So remember, we do the questions first, we look at the answers later on. Stick around where we'll find out exactly what is the correct answer. Number 7. Okay, I'll be interested to see how many of you get this one correct. So I've heard it's good, but I haven't read it. I haven't read it A, to me. I haven't read it B, myself. Or C, I haven't read it for me. So I've heard it's a good book, but I haven't read it. I haven't read it to me. I haven't read it myself. I haven't read it for me. So another grammar question here. And we've got A, to me. We've got myself. Nora's saying B, 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 myself. We have got a few more B's. We've got a C in there. But I think that C, B seems most popular. Myself, myself. Okay, good. Myself. Okay, so this is the most confident you have been throughout this quiz. It seems that most of you are going for B, myself. Stick around, we'll go through the answers very soon because we've only got one more question. Okay, round 8. Our final question. So we've looked at something similar this time last year or maybe 10 months ago. But we've chosen some different genres here. Which of these is not a genre or type of fiction? Which of these is not a type of fiction? So read the question carefully. Which of these is not a type of fiction? A, romance. B, biography. C, sci-fi. D, detective. E, fantasy. Or F, historical. So which of these is not a type of fiction? We have got D, we've got A, we have got, Emerald says biography is not fiction. We've got F says Ghazi, we've got A says Jessica, sci-fi says Angel, Spark Leo says B, Fong says B, biography. So Tawichai says F, E says Abdullahi. So the key to this one is reading the question carefully, looking at which of these is not a type or genre of fiction. A nice mixed bag. I'd say about 50% of you are going for biography, but some nice other answers coming in. So a good variety here. B, B, Angel, D. Elise is going for B's, but you sound a little bit unsure. And Nova and Huda are both going for F, historical. So, well done, everybody. You got to the halfway point where we've looked at the questions, and now we're going to look at the answers. This is the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz, if you have just joined us. And if you'd like to find out more from us, you can find us on bbclearningenglish.com, or you can find us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube for lots more. If I can ask a small favor, if you are having a good time, if you're enjoying, please hit that like button as we move on to the answer section. Right, question number 1. We were talking about quickly reading a book to get the main meaning of something. Do we call it A, scanning, B, speed reading, C, binging, or D, skimming? What do you think? Okay, so this is when we look through a book or magazine quite quickly, looking for the main part or the main meaning. 3, 2, 1. The correct answer is skimming. I think many of you had that right, but there were some, a lot of you going for scanning as well. The correct answer is skimming. Now, when you skim through a book or an article or a journal or a magazine. We're looking through it, looking for interesting parts and getting the main points or things of interest. We're looking for the gist, which is a nice word for the main idea. So you might have a book like this and I go, okay, not sure about this. Ooh, and I'll read this page here. And when I finish that, so you're just quickly going through it, finding bits of interest. So we often do this at university or in academic settings where we're looking for the main idea or something we can use in our own essays or research. And we also use it with magazines quite a lot. So maybe you're waiting at the dentist and you pick up a magazine and you look through it and you go, oh, I'll read this story. This looks good, but nah, not that one, not that one. Oh, this is interesting. So that's when you skim a book or a magazine. Did you get that right? Okay, so Haruno says, what does binging mean? I'll explain all the other words for you. So scanning is when you quickly look for information in a text. So maybe on your phone, when you go through your contacts to find a particular person, that is scanning. So you're quick. Aha, I found this particular information. For me, after the weekend, on Monday morning or Sunday night, I will scan through my bank statement looking for how much have I, looking for a particular payment. They go, oh, I spent how much at the restaurant? So when you're looking for particular information, specific information, that is scanning. Binging is a term we use to talk about watching lots and lots of TV shows at one time. So there's a show called Peaky Blinders in the UK. And I've been binging on them where I watched, you know, six straight after each other. That's binging. And then speed reading is a technique you can use to very quickly read lots and lots of information. And it's a useful technique for students who need to read lots and lots of information. So can you use these words in your own example sentences? So we can also surf on the internet. So we can say surf. But to be honest, Evgeny, it's a little bit old-fashioned. So when I was young, we'd say surfing on the internet, but we don't use that word so much. You just go, I'm on the internet or I'm browsing the internet. Okay. So we got somebody here for the first time. Hey, hello, welcome to joining us. Welcome to the show. Thanks for joining us. Okay. Good. Okay, got it. Glad to hear it. Let's have a look. Haha. So Kausa says, I'm familiar with skimming because of IELTS reading. If you're doing any sort of reading exam, skimming is a very, very, very important skill to learn because you've got to get the main idea very quickly. Okay. So skimming is tricky. It's like many skills, it takes practice. The more you do it, the easier it becomes. Huh. Let's have a look what else we got. And we got somebody else for the first time. Hey, hiya. Thanks for joining us. If you are enjoying, please hit that like button. And speed reading. So speed reading is a technique you can use to learn how to read very, very quickly. And this involves many people will read, and when they read, they will kind of talk to themselves. So they kind of talk to themselves while they're reading. Speed reading is a way of looking at big chunks of information. So you look at five words, so that you can read a page in just a few seconds or maybe 10 seconds and read a whole page. Okay. And we've got a nice example sentence from Tangina. Says, skimming it, her gaze settled on the last line of the first page. Lovely, lovely example sentence. Okay, binging is used for television shows, and it's when you watch many episodes of a TV show straight after each other. So you watch one, and it's so good, you go, ah, and watch another one. And that finishes, and you go, oh, and I have one more. And before you know it, you've watched lots and lots and lots of it. Okay, so I hope that is clear. On we go to round two, which was, an idiom round. And we're looking for which of these is not a book-related idiom. Two of them, are real idioms, and one of them is not. Which ones are which? Which of these is not a book-related idiom? What do you think? And I'm going to give you 5 seconds to get your answers in one more time. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And the correct answer is C. I mean, we got Madwa has been following our lives for a while, but I've never seen your comment on the screen. Apologies, we get loads and loads of comments coming in, and we can't always pick out everybody, but I try my best. Okay, so if you don't have your comment read out, I will try my best to get it out for you. Here, the one that is not a real idiom is off the book. Okay, so the correct saying, or the one that it sounds like, is off the hook. Hook with a H. And this means you are no longer in trouble or difficulty. And you can think of it as a fish who has taken the bait and is on a hook, but now the hook is off and they have escaped. The police couldn't prove he was guilty, so he was off the hook. He was no longer in trouble, no longer in difficulty, no longer in danger. That's off the hook is a real one. Off the book is not real. We do not use it. Next, what was A? Open book. A was open book. And this is an idiom used to describe someone who is easy to understand. You know them. They're very open with their feelings, open with their opinions. Easy to know them, easy to understand them. They don't hide anything. It's so easy to understand them. It's like they're a book and you can just read all about them. A closed book is the opposite. Someone who's very hard to know. They hide their true feelings. They're very private. They don't talk about their true feelings or their opinions, and they keep their guard up and they're a little bit distant. And you think, okay, I can't find their true self. I don't know what they're really thinking. They're a closed book. So do you know anybody who is an open book, or do you know anybody who is a closed book? Let me know in the comment section. Okay. Okay. Let me think about if we'd use it like this. So I don't, it's a good try, but I don't think we'd use it like this. We use it to talk about someone's personality. So not a small, I'm a closed book with my fancy goods. I don't think we'd use it like this. We talk about someone's personality in general. So you can say, I'm a closed book. I don't share anything about myself. So here it is. A closed book doesn't share things about themselves. That's the little difference there. An open book is an open mind. No, not quite. An open book is somebody who's easy to understand. They don't hide anything. If they think it, they say it. Okay? They are very truly themselves. You know them, you think that when they're in private and when they're in public, they're the same. Okay, we got hello from Bangladesh. Hi, Rabiul. Not really an extrovert. It's somebody who might be quiet, but when you speak to them, they are totally honest. It means very, very honest, very open, very honest. Okay, lovely example here. I know what he's thinking. He is an open book to me. I wish I was an open book. I mean, yeah, you go, I wish I was more honest with my feelings. Huda says, you must not always be like an open book. Okay, and Aline says, I'm a mixture of both. It depends on the situation. Same for me. Sometimes I'm very open, and sometimes it depends who you're with and how you're feeling. A little bit more of a closed book. Okay, Deepak says, I'm an open book person. We don't need the word person. We can just say, I'm an open book. Okay, my partner is a closed book. Okay, nice example. And same here. I prefer dealing with an open book person. We don't need to put the word person here. we can say, I prefer dealing with somebody who is an open book. Excuse me, my problems with my lighting. So it's going a little bit darker. Apologies for that. Okay, let's move on to round three. So a lot of you seemed quite familiar with this one. I was wondering how you would do. Loads of books over lockdown. I read A, B, I read C, I read it, or D, I reading. And because so many of you got this one correct, we're going to move on a little bit quicker than normal. 3, 2, 1. Yes, the answer is read, as Julia says, be read. This is because it is the past tense. And what Tashi said, but the pronunciation is read. Exactly that. So even though it's spelt the same, the pronunciation is different. I read loads of books over lockdown. Okay, so let's take a little bit of a look at this. So we're talking about the past. So we're looking for the past simple. Read or read. Read is an irregular verb. The infinitive is read. The past simple is read. And the past participle is read. So same spelling, different pronunciation. Let me give you some examples. I read a book every day. I read a book every day. I read a great article last night. So the past, I read a great article last night. And the past participle, I have read many books by that author. What book have you read recently? All right, so let's have a look. So yes, as Alessandra says, it's the simple past. Good. Nice. Okay, everyone has put the three different forms. Read, read, read. Okay, Tangina, 3 out of 3. Good job. How are you doing? Evgeny's asked a nice question about number 2. Is the expression an open book similar to somebody who wears their hat on their sleeve? Yes, it is. Okay, so somebody who wears the hat on their sleeve is open with their feelings. An open book is somebody who is also just quite open, easy to read. It's not quite exactly the same, but similar, very, very similar. Okay, I read the second chapter of Maths yesterday. Good here. Ooh, and Shaikh says, Can't Hurt Me by David Goggins, which is an excellent book, by the way. I thoroughly enjoyed that. A very interesting character. And we've got, how can I pronounce cut? Do you have the same pronunciations? Yes. I cut, I cut, I cut, I cut. Yeah. I have read loads of books. We can also use the present perfect here. Yes, we can indeed. Yeah, we can. If it's still ongoing, we could use the present perfect. Ragnarok, great choice with Dostoevsky. Fantastic. You've got some great choice in books here, everybody. Very, very nice choice. Okay. When I was young, the famous five were my favorite. Enid Blyton, the famous five, when I was young, are great choice. Okay, you guys are fantastic choice in books. I'm very impressed. All right. And one last example. I read a beautiful poem last Wednesday. Thank you, Chiara. That is fantastic. On we go. Question number 4. Yeah, so a little bit different here. And I realize that putting down the answer is not as easy as just putting A or B or F. But I thought I'd add a bit of reading for this, a bit more complicated to get this one. Okay, so we're matching the word on the left-hand side with the definition on the right-hand side. So we've got plot, chapter, and blurb. On the right-hand side, we've got the description of the book on the back cover, the main events of the book, and C, a section of the book. Amit says, I'm an open book. I am a little bit of an open book. I do agree. Right, so a few more seconds to get your answers in. Three, two, one. Yes. Okay. So we're going to look at them one by one. So the plot is the main story of a book or a film or a play. It's the storyline. It's what happens. Okay. It's the main idea. It's the story. So it's another word for the storyline. That is the plot. What's next? Is the chapter next? The chapter is the section of a book. And it's a way of dividing a book into manageable little sections and to show that a change of topic or change of scene is happening. We use chapters in both fiction and non-fiction books. And then the word blurb, which I like. It's quite a fun, interesting word to say, blurb. Blurb. I don't know why. I quite enjoy it. Blurb. It's just a good sounding word. This is a short description of the book that is written on the back cover. So it'll be on the back here, and you got a little bit explaining about the book, what it's about, and it tries to make you interested in buying or reading that book. Now, any questions about that? So Todd, the main events of the book. Excellent, got it. Aha, blurb is synopsis. It is indeed, yes. Okay, let's see what else we got. Oh, we got a teacher in who taught that to your students. We love teachers here at BBC Learning English. Good job. Mertoshon, sorry, that's probably terrible pronunciation of your name, but good job. You found every word correctly. Good. Okay. Let's have a look. Resume. Is the resume a blurb? No, a resume is when you are applying for a job. You put all your education and your experience on a document. That's a resume. A blurb is on the back of a book. So Kiara's asking for pronunciation of blurb. 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 So blurb. Okay, after me, herb. Blurb. Okay, hope that helps. So on the back of the book is a bit of information about the book, a synopsis, a summary of the main things that makes you want to read or buy that book. Okay, so a few of you asked about the pronunciation. I hope that helps. All right. To buy a book, you should read the blurb first. Absolutely. Okay, that's how you find out what is in that book. Okay, Salindra says there are 12, and you read all 7 Harry Potter books in 20 days. Very, very impressive. Okay, but yes, when you've got a very thick book, sometimes the blurb isn't able to tell you how deep and how interesting the story actually is. And some of you saying resume is the curriculum vitae or the CV. Yes. Short description of the book. Exactly. Yes. Good. Okay. You've got it. Good job. Whew. There's a lot of talking in this show. 45 minutes of me talking. Whew. Thirsty work. Right, round 5. Now, round 5 was Roy's question. If you enjoyed Roy joining the show, hit that like button, because we do appreciate him spending his time joining us, helping us out. Now, someone who reads a lot of books is called A, a bookworm, B, a reading mouse, or C, a novel cat. What do you think? Someone who reads a lot is called a bookworm, a reading mouse, or see a novel cat. What do you think? So you got a few seconds to get your answers in here. Okay, and while you're getting your answers in, JL has asked, how can you find the live program's timetable on YouTube or this channel? Every other Monday, we have Vocabulary Live, 1:30. Tuesday and Thursdays, we have Pronunciation Live, that's 1:30. Wednesday is the live grammar class, and every Friday is the live Friday quiz, 1:30 UK time. So, 3, 2, 1. Yes, as many of you got, the correct answer is a bookworm. So, a bookworm is somebody who reads a lot of books. They love reading, they love books. It can be used as a positive or a negative term. So it depends on your opinion, really. You can say, oh, she's not coming out again. She's too much of a bookworm, meaning she only wants to read. So it can be used as a negative thing. And I've heard it used a bit like dork or geek. But for me, I'm a bookworm. I love reading. I think reading's fantastic. I'm totally a bookworm. How about you? Would you be proud to be a bookworm? I thought interesting. What was choice number two? Reading mouse, because in the Romance languages, so that's Italian and Spanish and Portuguese and Romanian, I believe they're called a book mouse or a library mouse. Is anybody here that speaks French, Spanish, Portuguese, Romanian? Is the translation a book mouse? And in Norway, Norwegian people call it a reading horse. Okay, not a bookworm. Okay, but we got some people who are indeed. It's like they are eating books. Exactly that. They love them so much. Can't stop eating, devouring them. Okay, bookworm. I'm a bookworm. Topo di biblioteca. What is topo? What animal is a topo? Yes, bookworm, person who's addicted to books. If Janie's also a bookworm and a big Stephen Fry fan, me too. I think a lot of people were bookworms when they're younger and they sort of lose it, especially with so many distractions on the internet nowadays, isn't it? Book lover. It's your choice. A book lover is also fine, yeah. Or bookworm's a nice one too. All right then. So Ahmed saying, not a bookworm at the moment, but you're on your way. You're getting a love of books. Okay, so let's have a look. Top mole. Ah, a library mole. Interesting. Interesting indeed. Okay. B and D are not real words. They are not. We say bookworm. We do not say reading mouse. We do not say novel cat. Okay. Whew. Two more to go. Come on, folks. Let's do this. Huh. Okay. So in Spanish, Nancy says, raton de biblioteca. It's a bookworm. That's interesting because when I read online, it told me that it was reading mouse or library mouse. Okay. Question number six. Three more questions to go. What do we call the time and place where a story happens? What do we call the time and place where a story happens? Yeah, okay. Topo is mouse. Okay, that's what I read. That actually. So the time and place where a story happens, do we call it the location? Do we call it the setting? Or do we call it the event? What do you think? A, B, or C? Location, setting, event. The time and place where a story happens. 3, 2, 1. It is B, setting. Now, I think a lot of you got this one, but there was some debate about B or C. We're looking at the time and place where a story happens. So let me give you an example with some famous films, because we use this term setting with books, films, or plays, which often share a lot of the language of storytelling. So Star Wars is set in space and in the far, far future. Batman is set in Gotham City and in the present day, present time. So the setting is a noun, and it's used to describe the scene, the scenario, the where, and the when. We can also use set as a verb. So another film example would be Die Hard was set in Nakatomi Towers, which is a big skyscraper, in the 1980s. Now, can you use the noun setting or the verb set to tell me about where your favorite book is set? Okay, setting is the noun, yes. In literature, in film, in plays, the setting is very important, Alessandra. Good point, yes. Okay. So, Stephen or Stefan, 2 to 6, keep going. We've got a few more. Not correct this one. That's okay. There's a few more to go. Please differentiate these three words. I will. Don't you worry about it. I will be doing that. Yilin. Hi, Yilin. The setting of a story is where and when it takes place. So that's setting, okay? How about location? So location is a noun, and this is used to describe where something is. What is the location of your house? So that means what part of town, which city, which street, where is your house located? Okay, so it means where something is. An event is a thing that happens or takes place. And we especially use it when something, like when a thing happens, which is unusual or different or special. Okay, so setting of Crime and Punishment by Dostoevsky, a classic book, is in St. Petersburg. So Baker Street could be the setting, yes. Okay, so let's have a look. The set is important for the popularity of a movie. Yes, okay, good, nice example. We've got, at least the setting of this movie is really good. Aha, one of my favorite books, which is White Fang, is set in Canada. I love it. Great book, great example sentence. Okay, A Tale of Two Cities is an 1859 historical novel by Charles Dickens set in London and Paris. Very, very, very good example sentence there. Tangina, absolutely. This would be a beautiful setting for a picnic. Totally. Okay, let's have a look. Is it possible to say the location of my journey is the sea? The location of my journey is the sea. It sounds a bit unusual, to be honest, though, Jenny. It doesn't sound quite right. I'm not 100% certain what you're trying to say there. And one last one from Alessandro says, my favorite book is set in Dublin. Okay, cool. Great book. For this question, loads of great answers coming in. I can see loads and loads of really, really nice example sentences, but I can't read them all, and we have to move on. Round 7 was, you surprised me. You guys really were good at this one. I feel it's good, but I haven't read it. I thought this would be one of the trickiest questions, but many, many of you said the same answer. So what do you think? If you've just joined us in the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz, what do you think it is? A, to me, B, myself, or C, for me? I've heard it's good, but I haven't read it. To me, myself, for me, what do you think? And I can see, again, everybody's going for B. So loads and loads of you going for B. And that's good because it is the correct answer. I thought it'd be tricky, but you guys better, it surprised me by how great your knowledge of grammar is. So myself is a reflexive pronoun, and here it is used to make the situation more intense. It puts the emphasis on the subject, which is me. So we don't really need it here. So we could just say, I've heard it's good, but I haven't read it. Okay, that is fine. But when we add myself, we're kind of saying that it's surprising or it's important that I haven't read it. So you might say, many people have read the book, many people are talking about the book, and I've heard many good things, but I haven't read it myself. So it's put an extra emphasis on me. I'll give you two more examples. I think that's enough. On Saturday night, Jamie made dinner himself. So this might be highlighting that Jamie doesn't normally make dinner himself, and he didn't have help, any help from anybody. So we've added himself to show that, oh, this is interesting or different or surprising. Similar example here. Lots of our friends have been to Paris, but we haven't been ourselves. So even though many of my friends have, even though you might think I have, it's a bit surprising. So I've added ourselves at the end. Can you make an example sentence with myself? That's your challenge. Can you do it? Okay. My mother and myself made this pancake. Yes, so we make a pancake. Yes, and here's myself used in a different way, but that's good. Aha, oh, she did. Ah, okay, F.A. Rahimi. She did all her homework herself. Yes. I don't need anyone. I am good by myself. Excellent. I read it myself, Cindy. Very good. I have done it by myself. Yes, I believe in myself. Good. So, Jane, so with cake, we could say made the cake or baked the cake by, and Jane is a female name usually, so it would probably be by herself. Okay. I cook myself. So we need to put a bit of context here. So I cook myself means that you were cooking shalu for dinner. I cooked dinner myself. I cooked lunch myself. I cooked spaghetti by myself. So we need a bit of extra information here. Okay. I did it by myself. Good. Ooh, Aline's got a nice example. I have not been good to myself. I've been eating too much junk, i.e. too much junk food. I'm very familiar with this situation. Okay, and I will buy myself sneakers, and we'll do, I myself do all the work. Yes, this is no need for S, but we could use this actually. It's a little bit unusual, but we can use it. All right, and last one from Katerina. They have been to or on Komodo Island, but I haven't been there myself. Fantastic. And loads of you got loads of great examples. I just can't look at them all, but thank you for sending them in. Some really, really nice examples there. And on we go to question number 8. Question number 8 is, which of these is not a type of fiction? The key word here being fiction. So 5 of them are genres of fiction. One of them is not. Which one is the one that is not a type of fiction? Okay, McCann's going for B. We've got someone who's gone for G. Well, I'm not sure if you'll get this one correct, Pisces. We got biography, B and F. So it's, which of these? Aha, if you put which of these are not, then it could be two choices, is not. It's only one answer. You got A coming in. We got D, B and F, historical F. We've got B and F, F. So there's definitely some popular answers here. We got A. Dun, 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 dun. Drum roll, please. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. The correct answer is A, biography. This is not a type of fiction because it is a type of non-fiction. It is a book, but it's non-fiction. A biography or biography is it's a book which tells you a written history about somebody's life. So this is a real person and it tells you their story. It is factual. It is not fiction. However, it is not written by the person whom the book is about, because what is that called when somebody writes a book about themselves? Autobiography. So a biography is written the history of somebody's life by somebody else. If you do it yourself, that is called an autobiography. The others, romance is a love story. Sci-fi is using technology or set in the future. Detective is when there is a police officer, a detective, who goes and tries to solve a crime. So you can think of Miss Marple, you can think of Sherlock Holmes. For some examples of sci-fi, you think of 1984, Roy's favorite, or Dune, one of my favorites, or The Martian. Fantasy involves magic or the supernatural or an imaginary universe. So think about Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings and Alice in Wonderland. And then the one that some of you were confused, but I thought it might confuse some of you, so I put in as a trick answer, it's historical fiction. So these are novels, fiction books, which are set in the past, and they are often based around real life events. So you could have a historical fiction book about London during Shakespeare's time, or a historical novel about the life of a Roman soldier. Okay, so historical is a type of fiction. Okay. If I explained the World War II, would I be saying fiction? No, that would be described non-fiction. N-O-N hyphen fiction, non-fiction. Okay. You love to read biographies, says Rabiul. Vivian, you're missing out. I love sci-fi. Oh, sci-fi, it's so creative and so imaginative. Okay. Historical stories. Okay. We call it historical fiction. Okay. So these are made up stories. Okay. So the authors made it up, but it's set in the past around true events. So around the Fire of London or the Great Plague, or any war, in the past, they're real events, but you've made up a story with fictional characters. Okay, so we've got lots of you saying, well done, well done. How many did you get today? I think my gut feeling is that it was a little bit trickier than normal, but well done anyway, whatever your score was. So doing a quiz in a second language, not easy. So whatever score you got, be proud of yourself. You've spent the last hour learning language, listening practice. We had some natural conversation with me and Roy. We got vocabulary and grammar and idioms. You got to practice your writing. And we looked at some, little grammar points when people put their comments up. So there's loads of things for you to take away in this hour. Be proud of yourself. Good job, whatever your score was. Now, thank you all for joining, as always. Let me know, what topics would you like to discuss in future shows? So me and Rob need some ideas for next week and the week after. What topics would you like to discuss? Let me know. And if you do want to leave, anybody wants to shoot off, thank you for joining. You can catch us again next Friday, or check us out on Mondays, Vocabulary Live Lessons. Tuesday and Thursday with Nina, Pronunciation Live, and then Wednesday you got your grammar class, and me and Rob do the quizzes on Friday. Thank you all for joining. Lots of thanks coming in. I'll come back to that one in a minute. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you all. It wouldn't be anything without you guys here. And we got nature, nice idea. We got health problems. I can do health. It might be a bit more positive to just do health in general rather than health problems, but good one. We got movies. In the UK, we call them films, but yes, nice choice. Travel, money. Ooh, I like that one. Money might be an interesting one. I don't think we've done that yet. Islam, we could do one on religion. That's a nice idea. Colors, linking words. Some good ideas here. Inversion. I'd love to do it because I love grammar, but I think maybe some of you would fall asleep. All right. See you next Friday, McCann. Thank you all for joining. Pleasure to see you all again. I hope to see you all again, same time next week. Bye.